so closely. But just to give a very generalistic overview of the subject, I'm not going to speak on any technical aspect, but more of some very interesting aspect, the habitats and why India in general considered one of the biodiversity hotspot for coastal and marine biodiversity areas. India is among the top 12 mega biodiversity countries of the world, and there are a number of reasons why we rank so high, especially considering the fact that we have wide spectrum of different habitats and ecosystem, both aquatic as well as terrestrial. So far as marine part is concerned, we have 8,000 kilometer of coastal coastline spread across 9 coastal states and 4 union territories. We have more than 20% of our total coastline that is covered by one of the most biodiverse rich areas of Andaman Nicobar and Lakshadweep, and that contributes significantly to our coastal biodiversity richness. And we have a massive 2.02 million square kilometer of exclusive economic zone. Now that's where we have our large pelagic, whether it fish or marine mammals, you know, roam freely. Historically, there are about 9 critical habitats that have been identified along Indian coast, as you can see in this map. Andaman Nicobar, Lakshadweep, Gulf of Kutch and Gulf of Mannar. These really are some of the excellent reformation. Gulf of Khambat, more of mangrove mudflat habitat. So is Vetarkanika and Sundarban. Gulf of Malvern has got secondary reformations. So is Gulf of Karwar. But besides this 9, we have about 100 plus ecologically sensitive sites. Not yet officially recognized, but scientifically, these are key biodiversity areas and need some form of recognition in the form of either, you know, Wildlife Protection Act or Environmental Protection Act. And one of our efforts that BNHS Marine Team works is to identify these ecologically sensitive sites based on very robust scientific criteria. But if you look at the broad habitat types that we have spread across this, either 9 critical habitats or 100 plus ecologically sensitive sites, coral reef stands probably top in terms of the biodiversity richness part of its concern. It's very interesting fact that reefs actually are what we call it as nutrient deficient ecosystem. It means it produces very low nutrient load. And therefore, it requires very effective means of recycling that nutrients very effectively. And that is one of the reasons why these are extremely rich in biodiversity. If you look at the status of coral reefs of India, as I said, broadly, there are 4 key reformations. Gulf of Mannar is about 94 square kilometer. Gulf of Kutch, about 325 square kilometer. Andaman Nicobar 1021, Lakshadweep Island 934, and recently spotlight that has received by Angria Bank, which is about 40 nautical mile offshore submerged reef bank. It's about 30 meter below water, is roughly about 400 square kilometer. Now that constitute bulk of our coral reef areas, and then we have plenty of secondary reef formations like Malvern. There are a lot of patchy reefs in Goa, all across states you will find, except of course West Bengal and Orissa, you will find these scattered reefs, patchy reefs across all the coastal states. The reefs are structurally quite different at all these places. As I've said, Angria Bank is a slightly deeper reef. The reef starts at about 30 meter depth. And it's offshore, so its structure is slightly different than the one we have, for example, in Ratnagiri in Vijayadurg, which is, we call it as very patchy reef formation. Netrani of Karnataka, again, is slightly different in terms of structure. Lakshadweep, again, is very, very distinct atoll reef formation, which you don't see otherwise in any other reef ecosystems in India. While on east coast, we have again Gulf of Mannar, where sediment load is extremely high, and the reef formation here again is very, very different. Andaman Nicobar again is a mix of different habitats. It has got mangroves, fringing reefs, as well as pure sandy coral sand associated reefs. Then mangrove formation, again on east and west coast of India, we have got some spectacular mangroves. And if you look at the status of mangroves since 1987 to 2011, in many parts, especially in Gujarat and Maharashtra, mangrove cover has been increasing over a period of time. I'm not going to dwell much on the reasons for that, but there is a good degree of growth of mangroves seen in certain areas. To certain extent, it is attributed to two factors. I think a lot of afforestation that has been taken place, unfortunately, mostly by monoculture plantation of Avicennia, but also for the fact that sea level rise is causing some degree of increase in the mangrove cover in certain areas. I'll probably show one slide at the end of it. Then we have some excellent seagrass beds. Unfortunately, seagrass are doing extremely badly in India. And the most dominant seagrass beds are now predominantly either in Lakshadweep, Gulf of Mannar, Palk Bay, or Andaman Nicobar Island. Most of the places, we are losing seagrass very, very rapidly. And as you know, there are two flagship species completely dependent on seagrass ecosystem, dugong as well as green sea turtles. Mudflats, as most of the people consider them as barren seascape, and that's a very unfortunate term people use for mudflats. In fact, these are equally productive ecosystems, and large number of migratory birds use this ecosystem for foraging, because it provides a very important food source for these migratory birds. If you look at again the spread of coastal wetlands, both vegetated and non-vegetated, as well as intertidal mudflats, we have about 4 million hectares of coastal wetlands spread across various states and UTs, and about 2.4 million hectares of intertidal mudflats. Now, that's one of the key reasons why India receives such a high density and high number of migratory birds, especially from the breeding ranges into Arctic Russia. Sandy shores and sand dunes, again, extremely popular for tourist point of view. And depending on the tides, the wind, the current, the sandy shores again are divided into three broad types, reflective, dissipative, and intermediate. Let's not go into the science of it, but they play important role in terms of suitability for number of other aspects, including recreational plus sea turtle nesting, erosion, and so on and so forth. Sandy shores, again, Tamil Nadu has got about 9,000 plus hectare. Andhra Pradesh has got highest on the east coast, while on the west coast, Gujarat has got the highest distribution of sandy shore and sand dunes. Sand dunes again are very, very vital, especially in the for the fact that sea level rise is a reality, and that's happening. No matter at what proportion and percentage is happening, it's happening for sure. Sand dunes are going to play a very critical role preventing salt water ingress into the terrestrial scapes around the coastal areas. And therefore, protection of sand dunes is very, very vital. Unfortunately, as mudflats, sand dunes also are considered as one of the impediment, especially in CRZ perspective. And in most of the states, sand dunes have diminished very rapidly in last couple of decades. Again, there are different types of dunes. You know, the four dunes are parabolic or transgressive dunes, which based again on various processes of sand movement that has been formed. Some of the excellent sand dunes you will see in the states of Tamil Nadu, Orissa, Andhra. While as on the west coast, we have very few areas left with good sand dune covers, unfortunately. And one of the most popular habitat for all of us actually is intertidal areas. And the reason is that this is the most accessible habitat that one can have to go around and explore marine and coastal biodiversity. Compared to all other habitats, whether it's reef or whether it's mangroves or seagrasses or mudflats, intertidal areas are very different in the sense that these areas get exposed twice during the day to the low tides and surface air ambience, all those fluctuations you may call for, whether it's temperature, whether it's salinity or predatory exposure and so on and so forth. So intertidal areas are far more dynamic, and this is the only probably ecosystem where you have within two-dimensional seascape, you will see three-dimensional space in the form of rock pools. And that's something very interesting part to study for intertidal areas. Having said that, these are also some of the most explored areas because of their easy access. You can work there for a long period of time depending on where you are. It gives ample amount of time for researchers to explore the diversity and its interaction with its microhabitat. So intertidal areas are popular. They have, of course, been exposed to all kind of vagaries, both natural and man-made. But we still have some of the very good intertidal areas for marine biologists to go and explore across various parts of this country. Then coastal lagoons, we have both on east and west coast of India. A good number of lagoons, again, that attract a lot of waterfowl, ducks and geese, which are migratory, again, on annual basis. And then we have got unique atoll ecosystem in Lakshadweep Archipelago, where you will see landmass is relatively very small, like whether it's in Bitra or Minicoy. And you have a massive lagoon surrounding the island. In Androth, however, you will see there is no lagoon because it's fully matured atoll, where lagoon has completely been lost. This is how the islands in Lakshadweep look. Very, very distinct ecosystem. Very, very interesting also area to work for and study marine and coastal biodiversity. Coastal wetlands, again, are very, very unique in the sense that even urban wetlands, for that matter, provides some spectacular spaces for migratory birds. This is imaged by Pratik Chorge, which I really liked, and I requested him to use this. He's taken this of the flamingo congregation at Talaude wetland, which is recently been great circulation in social media about this massive congregation of flamingos that has seen this year. And this flamingo number has been increasing consistently for last almost 10 to 12 years. Again, I'm not going to dwell into science of it, but it's a very, very interesting science of why these flamingos are here. But coastal mudflats are again very, very important. Even urban coastal wetlands, no matter how small they are, they can actually be an excellent refuge for a large number of fauna and flora. Marine biodiversity, I'm going to run through very quickly through some of these 7 or 8 slides. It's extremely colorful, extremely rich, and also many of it are getting extremely endangered. That's not something which we should be proud for. Definitely. And the list of endangered species, they may not necessarily be listed either in IUCN Red List or any other listing, but definitely their populations are not doing very good in all along the coastal areas, not just in India, but globally. Dugong, for example, we don't know really the exact population of it. It has been assumed that it can be anywhere between 100 to 400 individuals that we have left in Andaman, Nicobar, and Gulf of Mannar, mostly a small population in Gulf of Kutch, but we don't know exact number there. We sporadically are getting carcasses, and on and off, we have got some of these feeding trails in Gulf of Kutch. But these are the only two places, Gulf of Mannar, Pal Bay, and Andaman, Nicobar, where we have this last remaining population. Whale shark doing relatively better after the large campaign that has been undertaken for almost last 2 decades to save this species across Indian coast. Then we have got humpback whales, and we have got all kinds of shark species, mostly pelagic shark species, rugged tooth sharks or oceanic white tip, this leatherback turtle, then oceanic white tip, oceanic silver tip. Even manta rays today, we understand that there is a bit of harvesting going on for this large majestic fishes, which is not a very good sign to say. The blue whales, then your hawksbill turtles, all of these species today are entering into the list of either endangered or critically endangered species because of our entire reckless approach towards dealing with marine and coastal biodiversity. These are again, you know, images of hawksbill and green sea turtles from Lakshadweep. This is one of the best places where you can actually see them. You know, they're just gliding into this beautiful, tranquil blue waters with absolutely beautiful clarity. Fishes, we have wealth of fishes, both not just in coral reef areas, but also in other ecosystem types and habitats, including the pelagic fish fauna. Then whole range of echinoderms, both sea cucumbers, starfishes, sea urchins, brittle stars, then shrimps and crabs. They all come in various forms, fashions, and colors. That makes the entire marine ecosystem much more colorful than you can even imagine. I feel it's far more colorful than the terrestrial life is concerned. The only caveat is that if you go below 10 feet, 10 meters, sorry, then the colors will disappear unless you use a specialized illumination. So you have to have good quality underwater lighting to see this beautiful color. Otherwise, below a 10 meter, all you see is a monochromatic kind of ecoscape. I mean, our eyes are not able to see those colors without support of an artificial light. And if you see this middle image in the soft corals, if you can see my cursor, middle row, second from the left, that's how monochromatic it will look without light. And the moment you put flash, then the middle row, left hand side, the deep red orange color will come out very well. So, and then see animals, full range of adaptations you will see in these beautiful animals. Not much really is known. Recently, there's hardly any work on sea anemones of India. It's a good area for young researchers to go. Even worms in marine realm look extremely colorful. They are not like this drab, dull-looking earthworm. They, of course, are very valuable in terms of ecosystem. I'm only giving connotation to its color. Even worms look beautiful in a marine realm. But Mother Nature is spectacular. I mean, besides being very colorful, they have some fantastic ecosystem roles, and these are real unsung heroes, I call it, as for survival of this entire planet and coastal ecosystem. Now look at this tiny sand bubbler crab. The kind of vital role they play of nutrient recycling is so important. These are the true ambassadors of Swachh Bharat. They clean out the organic debris that come with every high tide, clean it with, use it as a food, and release nitrogen-packed feces out into water. Now, these are the invaluable contributions these small, tiny animals play knowingly, unknowingly, as a part of their daily routines, which keeps our oceans very, very healthy. Humped parrotfish, not very commonly found, mostly seen in Andaman, Nicobar, you know, those kind of reef areas. They produce a very important vital sand. I mean, they feed on corals. And while feeding on corals, they convert these large coral boulders into fine reef sand, which is so important, especially for the island ecosystem. At the same time, they release the nitrogen-packed feces into seawater in a reef ecosystem, which I said earlier, is one of the nutrient-deficient ecosystems. So it have to have very effective nutrient recycling process. Otherwise, the reefs cannot survive on its own because it is of this nutrient deficient kind of you know, situation. Then the spectacular Olive Ridley Aribadas of Orissa. There are only two places on earth where you will see more than a million sea turtles coming to shore in a very small place, in one tiny, you know, three tiny areas of Rishikulya Devi and Bitarkanika in Orissa. I mean, these are some of the most remarkable things that we are blessed with as a country. And we need to do a lot of introspection as to what we are doing to enter our coastal ecosystem and habitats. Look at these giant bivalves, which has a life of more than Earth, all of us, human beings, and 200 years plus they live, grow over a meter in length, feed exclusively on zooxanthellae. They are what we call it as autophagous. They cultivate algae inside their body. How remarkable adaptation in a nutrient deficient system like reef, when there is lack of nutrition, then you have your own cultivation system. So these stridacnates cultivate zooxanthellae, the single cell microscopic algae, in its body. And during the adverse condition, it will feed on this reserve stock of food. And that's one of the reasons why this clam can actually survive for so long, that they're autophagous, they produce their own food. And again, sea cucumbers, a very, very interesting species, which has got an exceptional, probably among the animal kingdom, this is one species which has got the most exceptional regenerational capacity of its own body organs. I mean, this animal can throw out all its body organs and regenerate the entire internal system again in a very short span of time. Now, these are also the species can provide us a lot of scientific inputs for example, regenerative disorders. How we can learn from these animals is something, which is very, very important. Therefore, we need to save this biodiversity for our own sake of survival. Box jellyfishes, frighteningly powerful venom that any marine animal can produce. 99% of his body mass is water. That's how I can describe these beautiful jellyfishes. The entire animal would be probably less than 2 centimeters, but tentacles can grow up to 3 meters. But this tiny animal, why this tiny animal need to have such a lethal venom, nobody knows. But yet it is one of the most powerful toxin that man has seen, and it has caused number of fatalities across the world. It's not to scare, but just to let you know that some of these animals are expanding their distributional ranges in a context of warming seas. And that's something we need to be mindful for. And I'll speak a little bit about it in last couple of slides. And then we have got marathon swimmers, is how these animals navigate these featureless oceans, every year after year. Humpback whales about 22,000 kilometer Antarctic to Pacific, northern seal 21,000 kilometer. I just pick few examples. There can be hundreds of examples. Leatherback turtle, one of the most well-studied turtle in terms of its migration, including some of excellent research done in India by the Indian researchers in Little Andaman and Great Nicobar. But all is not well for all this rich and beautiful biodiversity. And in last 5-6 slides, I'm going to dwell a bit upon where the problems for conservation rest with. It's a large country. It's a country with 1.2 billion people. And people have got different kinds of aspirations. Today I aspire to be I want to save my environment. That's my aspiration. So I have my lifestyle I have made according to what best I can do with it and deal with it. But people have different aspirations. And bulk of our people who live below poverty line, they simply have no time to think for environment, because their entire day-to-day struggle goes for meeting their daily needs of survival. Now, that's exactly where our dilemma rests. And therefore, we kind of left with very limited choices as to how we want to develop. I think we have taken probably a wrong path of development about 5-6 decades ago. That's industrial revolution. And we thought probably that's the best way for the country to go forward, to develop and give better life to the people of this country. And then you see these tragic images of the entire garland that you see. Actually, it's not a garland. These are all various kinds of projects either those are come up along our coast or they are slated to come up at various stages of clearances with state and government of India. Now those in these projects goes from all sectors. It's not just one sector. It's, you know, ports, then they have got power plants, both nuclear, thermal, gas based, and then we have got ship breaking unit. There are structures, there are settlements, there are sea walls and sea groins. You take the name of a sector and that exists along this coast. If that is what, how our coast is going to look, if not now, it's another two decades down the line, then what is the future for our coastal fishermen, especially the artisanal and traditional fishermen? They are virtually left with no choice but to be as slaves. I mean, that's the model, unfortunately, today we are looking at in terms of the developmental goals, unfortunately, for this country. But sustainable, you know, development also is, it sounds very glamorous. Actually, it doesn't really work in that sense in every single aspect. We have to look at it into case-by-case aspect. And the real challenge for us now is with this level of population, with very high poverty level, striking balance between conservation and development is going to be our daily conflict. It's not going to be just one time kind of fix solution that we can fix this problem with. Look at the industrial fishing fleets. On one side, we have got land-based pressure on these coastal areas in terms of traditional and artisanal fishers. Plus, this scale of industrial fishing. And these are the fishing boats mapped on a daily basis, because all these large fleets have to have the GPS tracks and they have been monitored. If this kind of intensive fishing we are doing in our ocean, how long will this this pieces of fish will take this pressure of fishing and yet continue to breed successfully and maintain the population that are necessary for ecosystem processes? Look at this left side map of India. Thousands and thousands of boats are today fishing legally, illegally, all around us. No wonder that our problems with fishermen stems from both the sides, that we have issues of land to sea degradation, and then we have degradation of sea in itself because we are intensely using these resources. Natural disasters also has its own play and role in ecosystem processes. El Nino, which is more of a natural phenomena, which has been happening for millions of years. We only started understanding the impact of El Nino only after 1998 Super El Nino that we had, where bulk of our coral reefs have bleached and died. But in last decade or so, we heard so many cases where El Ninos have killed reefs globally. Last three consecutive El Ninos, whether it's in Great Barrier Reef. Currently, there is an active El Nino going on in northern Indian Ocean. So most of our reefs in Lakshadweep, for example, are bleached. In Gulf of Kutch, we have seen a lot of bleaching. In Gulf of Mannar, there is bleaching. These are the natural processes, and we virtually have no control on some of these processes. But if you look at this particular graph, this is a paper we recently published when I was working for my PhD on Tridacna. We collected this almost 17-year data on this particular species. But we also looked at what is happening to our mean sea surface temperature. And if you look at these trajectories in 1960s, the normal threshold that time was between 26 degrees centigrade to 28 degrees centigrade. Now that's a perfect, I would say, a comfort zone for corals to live and flourish. Because up to 29 degrees centigrade, coral growth is quite nice and that's the most preferred temperature regime. But when temperature crosses 29, that's where coral starts bleaching. And if that bleaching episode extends for more than 3 to 4 weeks, then that bleaching can lead to mortality. Now, if you look at since 1960s, up to 1990, I would say up to 2000, temperature regimes were quite, you know, well below 29 degrees centigrade. It's only after 1998 when we first time realized the peak of, you know, this bleaching. Thereafter, you look at the thresholds, how many times annually the sea surface temperature has breached 29 and 30 degrees centigrade. Almost five times in a span of last 20 years. Now, that's a scary situation because usually the coral reefs will take between 10 to 20 years to recover from a massive bleaching episode. Now, here we are talking about five large bleaching events into this region, which is not allowing our coral reefs to recover naturally, the pace with which they should recover. Now, besides these natural threats, then anthropogenic stresses add one more additional layer of problems for these natural recovery processes. The only way we can control this is reduce anthropogenic stresses, because we have no control on El Nino processes, definitely not. But definitely we can control anthropogenic stresses, especially when we know reefs are going to bleach and we get a heads up well in advance because of technology now, that we should make a conscious efforts to reduce our pressure in terms of reduced fishing or fishing closure or tourism closure for the sake of giving that breathing space to our ecosystems. Sea level rise is a reality, and that's the last issue. I'll show a couple of slides and take question answer. People get thrilled to see this large waves splashing in Mumbai, those who are familiar with this you know, scenes annually. But as a climate conscious person, these images worries me most, because this is a symptom of a disease that is coming to us, and that disease is sea level rise. And sea level rise will hit us hard, and we will be able to do nothing. I don't think humans have power to stop incoming sea at any point of time. The only way we can deal with is strengthen CRZ, build a human resilience to deal with this consequences and uncertainties of climate. That's the only way we can handle this at individual level. And just to give one example, is to where our mangrove increase is coming, and we are having a different level of conflicts that is coming to us sooner than later. Look at 1990 image on the left hand side. The all green what you see is a paddy cultivated area, and red was the mangrove cover in 1990 in this one small creek in Karanja Creek, that's in Raigad district. And look at in 2019, in a span of three decades, 60 square kilometer of cultivable agriculture paddy land converted to mangrove because of saltwater ingress into these areas. Now, that ingress is not because of anything else except sea level rise. There is no other reason why there is so much of salt ingress into this area. And this is just one case study I'm talking about. There are hundreds of case studies that I can give you where seawater ingress has taken over agricultural land. Somewhere it may be few acres, few hectares. Somewhere it is few square kilometers. But here we are creating another level of conflict. I mean, I can understand a grieving farmer in this area can say, what you know, love I will have for mangrove when I have lost my livelihood in terms of my land because of the seawater. And unless we build that resilience and give them an alternate employment or livelihood avenues to deal with this changed reality of sea level rise and loss of this very productive agricultural lands, this problem only is going to go up. And that's a newer frontiers of conflict that we are going to see in years to come. And if people start cutting down these mangroves, there is very little we can do except showing them a scare of the law. But what law also will do when these people have lost their livelihoods, and we have not prepared these people well in terms of these impending threats that are going to hit us very hard in a context of climate change. I will stop here. I'm not going to take much of your time presenting. It is more interesting to see question answer rather than it's just a monologue of me talking for anymore further. Thank you.